Well, you're joining me today at Butterley Reservoir, which is a fantastic place. As you can see, there's a lot of ice on today, which isn't very handy for fishing, if I'm being honest. But that's not why we're here. We're actually here to run through a little bit of casting and to try and help you to improve your casting, because believe you me, casting is a massive part of any fishing that you're likely to do with the feeder or with a waggler. So let's run through a few things that can help. First of all, I want to talk a little bit about the setup. The first thing has to be the tackle. And that is what has changed so much in recent years, okay? A long while ago, I remember going fishing, thinking I could cast a long way, probably about 45 meters, and I had a softish 12-foot rod with light feeders and light line, and I was trying to cast it out without it breaking, and generally was unsuccessful. Small reels, all these sort of things didn't help. Nowadays, there's plenty of tackle out there available to help you get that extra distance without really changing anything about your casting technique in the first place anyway. So I like to look at that to get it right. The reel has to be a very, very important place to start. Now this is an Extremity 620 reel. It's got a really, really big spool, okay? That is absolutely essential when you're looking to cast long distances. I've talked about this before, but I know that these bigger spools are giving me 10% more on my casting straight away. I've been out and tried it for myself, and I know, compared with a smaller reel, I'm getting that benefit. It allows me to load the line up nicely, and the line comes off the spool really easily. There's also a benefit in the fact that it winds in quite nicely as well. It's quite a slow retrieve, which means I'm not worrying about spinning up, but I'm also getting a big turn on every turn of line, which helps when I'm winding in from long distances. So when you've got a reel like this, it really does help. Now, along with the reel, you obviously need a rod that can cope with that sort of casting. Today I'm using the 12-6 Supera in 80 grams. It's got a lot more backbone in this lower part of the rod, and it allows me to load the rod up nicely and help propel the feeder out there. I'm not going to be casting 50, 60 meters with 10 and 15 gram feeders. I'm going to need heavy feeders, 45 gram or possibly more depending on the conditions. So I need the meat in the rod to cast. This is also a 12.5 foot rod, which is really important as well. Don't be trying to cast massive distances with short rods. You can get a massive benefit straight away by using the length of the rod to help propel the feeder out there. And at 12.5 foot, it's really, really fishable. And it's a really, really nice rod to use. So that is a really important aspect of what I'm talking about here, having the right reel and the right rod to do the job. So if you're going to go out and you're going to cast these distances, that is where you've got to start. It's also very important to talk about the mono that you're going to use on your reel. Now, in the summer, I might use braid if I was fishing for smaller fish, but a lot of the time in winter, I'm going to be chucking distance method feeders. So I like to have mono on there, especially for carp. And what I've found is if you get the right mono set up, it doesn't hinder your distance at all. The first thing you've got to think about is the line you put on the reel, the main bulk of the line. Now I'm using 020, which is 5 pound sinking feeder mono. I wouldn't look to go any heavier than this when I'm looking to cast big distances. I've seen people trying to cast with these short feeder rods and light feeders with 8 and 10 pound line. Now if you use 8 and 10 pound line all the way on your reel, it's going to cause huge resistance off the spool, and it'll really, really massively affect your distance. It'll drag you back 20, 30 meters. I've seen it happen a lot. It's okay if you're carp fishing and you're using big leads with big rods, the lead is heavy enough to pull the line off the reel. But with the setups that we use in a lot of the smaller course fishing that we do, you've got to make sure that your line is balanced. Now, if you're going to use 020, you're not going to be able to cast off that all day without potentially damaging your line and having it break. So you've got to use it in line with a shock leader. Now, shock leaders are so easy to use. If you've never tried it, you've got to try it because it's so simple to do. I'm using 10 pound 028. Shock leader, okay, in the same sinking feeder mono. Now this stuff's bulletproof. I've cast well over 100 meters with this all day. I don't have to worry about it parting or letting me down. Unless I mistime a cast when anything's going to break, this sort of line's going to be absolutely perfect. And all I do is simply put 8 meters of this onto my reel with a simple four-term water knot, and we'll show you how to do that. So I'm going to talk about how I like to tie a shock leader knot. You've got to remember that we're fishing with very thin monos in 020 and then an 028 shock leader, okay? And I've done a lot of experimenting, and for me, the nicest knot is actually probably the simplest, which is just a three-term water knot. So I've got some light line here, which will be imitating my reel line, just in a different color so you can see it. And then I've got the 10-pound sinking feeder mono. Now, the first thing is the length of this that I need. I like to have about 8 meters. To me, it really doesn't matter what rod length, 8 meters seems to work nicely every time. So I just keep that the same every time. Now, all I do that is I just pull a wide arm span, and I know that if I do that four times, that's very roughly 8 meters. I've measured it several times and it's always there or thereabouts, and that's what I'm looking to have. And I just trim that off there. So I've got my line here. Now I'm just going to tie this water knot for you. It's really simple to tie. So just keep your two tag ends facing the opposite way, and then all I do is form a nice loop and pull the two loose ends through the loop three times. Now you can imagine you're obviously pulling 8 meters of line through the loop, but it's not a problem. You can just, it's loose line, you can just pass it down onto the floor, and it's really simple to pull through. Just don't pile it on top of anything. I'm gonna do one more. You can see how quick it is to tie. It really doesn't take any time at all. And that's it, perfect. So I'm gonna pull down on this now, nice and tight, like that. Just wet that up. And that is such an unbelievably neat yet strong knot. And you can just simply tie whatever feeder rig you want to the end of that 10-pound line. Having a shock leader like that makes a big difference to your fishing. And this knot is so neat, you won't even notice it going through the ring. Certainly once you start fishing, you won't notice it at all. So I'm just trimming up these two tag ends there so you can get a really close view. I mean, look at that. That is a super, super neat knot, and one that's perfect for using shock leaders with light lines for stronger ones. So it's important that we talk about the type of feeder that we're going to use as well when we're casting. There's certain things that are going to give you big advantages. I always think when I'm casting over about 30 meters, whenever I've got any bit more distance, the most important thing on my feeder is to have the weight down, all right? And we say that as a term, weight down on your feeder. A great example is the winder feeder. Now, this is my go-to choice of feeder when I'm fishing, natural style feeder fishing. I can fill it with bait, but look at that, the weight's on the base. It literally flies out weight first, and it keeps its line really well, which is so, so important. When you use a feeder with the weight on the side, it can deviate a little bit. When you punch it to start with, it can go offline, or maybe the wind will blow it off course. But if you've got something with the weight at the bottom, it'll catapult out in line with where you want to cast. So there's no reason why that shouldn't apply to your method feeder as well. And that's what we've done with the distance method feeders. So here, all the weight is at the bottom. You can see it's got a thickened base here at the bottom. That also helps act as a shield when the feeder's coming down into the water. And there is protection there, but it really acts as a casting aid. And you can't believe how straight these cast. They punch out straight and they go exactly where you're casting. So distance and accuracy can be benefited massively by the type of feeder you use. So think about that when you're choosing the feeder. So now we've got what I consider the ultimate setup and everything that's going to help us to achieve the distances and accuracy and reliability that we need when we're casting. Let's just have a little look at technique. Now, I find this quite interesting actually, the whole casting technique. There's a little bit of a debate when people want to cast a long way. In carp fishing,
a lot of the guys want to cast a long way and they end up having like little competitions and stuff like that for distance. And their technique is very much a hold the rod back, keep everything angled, arms high, and then push and power through towards your target. Now, that's absolutely great, and that is going to achieve a lot of distance. You've got to remember that they've got big heavy leads on. They've also got incredibly strong rods that need compressing in order to catapult that lead out. As match anglers and course anglers and general anglers who are fishing with lighter tackle, we don't need that same sort of compression and action into our casting. Accuracy is absolutely key for us, and achieving that certainly comes from a couple of things for me. Now, the first thing is with accuracy, I always want to make sure that I'm perfectly in line with my target. And to do that, I do that in two or three ways. First of all, I like to have around about 4 foot of line between my feeder and my tip, and I'll look at the target. Now, today I've got a perfect target. I've got a white post in the distance, something that I can cast at perfectly. So when I bring the rod forward, I like to swing the lead very slightly out at the target, almost as if that's where I'm going to cast it. And that just helps me get into a bit of a rhythm. And then I bring the lead back almost straight with the rod. So when I end up behind myself, the rod is pointing straight at the target, and then I can push the rod through at the target. Everything straight. Now, this whole thing is all about a technique and a continuance and a rhythm and getting everything that helps you to sort of combine everything together. I think a lot of people, when they come back and they stop and they hold, yes, you can cast nicely with that, but I think the feeder swings around behind you a little bit and it can affect your timing. To get a consistent timing, I like to get myself into a little rhythm. So I'm going to do it here and talk you through it as I do it. So I just swing that lead out, bring it back straight, and as I feel it behind me, I use the compression of the rod to go out and hit the target. And that helps me to cast, because every single time I cast, I've got that same technique and rhythm, and I'm allowing myself to feel the feeder behind me as I compress the rod. And by that I mean, as I bring the feeder back, you can actually feel when the feeder gets to almost like its heaviest point, which allows you to then catapult it forward. You've got to remember that casting is all about timing. We're fishing well in excess of 60 meters here today, which is a really, really big cast. Don't get confused to thinking you have to cast massive distances. I've been fishing my entire life and can honestly say I haven't fished over 70 meters more than a handful of times, because it's just not necessary. It's more important to be accurate in that 40, 50, 60 meter range where you're looking to do a lot of your fishing. So this technique that I'm showing you here today is really going to help you with that. You can stand up if you want to, but a lot of the time, if I've got the clearance behind me, I'm happy to sit down, because it keeps my core nice and stable. It means I'm not going to rock about and I can cast towards the target. So I'm just going to run you through that again, and I am going to pause at a couple of moments, all right? So one of the moments to pause at is as I come forward. So I come forward there and I'm swinging, and you can see I've got my left arm right on the butt of the rod, not halfway up the rod, right at the end. I'm going to use the full lever of the rod to help catapult the feeder out there. And then I like to personally hold on to the line. Some people like to fish with their finger on the spool. It doesn't really make any difference. It's whatever you're comfortable with. And then I'm bringing the feeder back. Now, as I bring the feeder back, I can feel it then. I'm going to use the left hand to pull down into my body as I use the right hand to guide the rod in a straight line. All right, so the power comes with the left hand and the right hand is a guide. So in quick motion, that's back and cast towards the target. Okay, and you can see there, we're right on it. Now that's really, really nice. It's all about timing. It also means as I bring that feeder back, my rig is all nicely straightened out behind me. Everything's straight. There isn't a whiplash effect or anything on my bait. It's just coming back nicely and then almost lobbing it out to the distance that you need. And what you've got to remember is, ultimately, you're a fisherman, okay? You're trying to fish. And when you cast out there, your bait's got to be in perfect presentation. So using this technique that I'm showing you here today allows me, with a little bit of practice, to get and fish well as much as possible, which is ultimately what it's all about, okay? As you get bigger distances, I've cast with this technique up to 120, 130 meters, which is never a distance that any of us are likely to fish. So I know that I don't have to worry about sort of keeping it at 90 degrees, keeping my arms high up in the air or anything like that. I can just use a nice smooth technique, 4 foot a line every single time to the tip, swing that rod forward, swing it back smoothly and punch it out towards the target. And that is how I like to cast, and getting into something like that will really help with your casting too. So take those advice on board, go out there, have a little practice, and I'm sure you'll be hitting those distances with accuracy in no time.